Have you seen the movie The Joker? Like, I just feel like now Britain, it's not a clown, you know, but a Joker in charge, right? Who wants to actually destroy the country, it seems, to outsiders.
Well, sadly, that seems to be the case. Anyway, get back to ice. Both of the two of the large foundations that are concerned with ice problems, that's the Healthy Climate Alliance in the US and the Climate Repair organization set up by Sir David King in Britain. Both of them have stressed the importance of bringing back Arctic sea ice as a separate item in their manifesto. So you're trying to bring back Arctic sea ice sort of independently of cooling the planet as a whole. Now, the question is why and how can we do this? And the first question is why, when obviously you expect ice will come back if we can manage to cool the planet. But the two of the whys that are being really identified in reports in the last day or two, in fact, concern the impact on methane emissions and on the Greenland ice sheet. The Greenland ice sheet is fairly simple what's happening, that is to say, with sea ice retreating in the summer now, Greenland, the island of Greenland, is now surrounded by open water, and that brings a much higher air temperature than you would get in the old days when you had ice around Greenland all the time. And that warmer air now causes melting all through the summer of the entire surface of the Greenland ice sheet. And I was up on the ice sheet on August the 1st this year, and that was a day on which there was more melt than any other previous recorded day in history since they started doing measurements. And that was 12.5 billion tons of ice melting off the Greenland ice sheet in one day. All of that ice goes into the ocean, and that increases the rate of sea level rise. As Peter said, sea level rise is now occurring 7 times as was, rather, Greenland ice sheet melt is occurring 7 times as fast as it was a few years ago, and that means sea level rise, for which Greenland is largely responsible, is also going to be increasing at 7 times the rate, which is bad news for the inundation of the coastlines around the entire planet, both cities and rural districts, especially regions where there are poor people living who can't afford to raise the heights of their flood defences. That's the first one. The second one is methane, and again that was the subject of a report very recently. And that's because one of the big sources of methane emissions at the moment or in the future may be the Arctic Ocean itself. Because the Arctic Ocean is the sea ice is retreating, and that's leaving a huge area of the Arctic free of ice in the summer. And that's an area of shallow water where the water, if there's no ice there, the water warms up. And that warmer water has an impact on the seabed. It melts out a layer of permafrost, which at the moment sits on the seabed, protecting us from what lies underneath the seabed, which is a very large thickness of sediments that are full of methane. So that methane, which is present combined with ice, can be released if that seabed permafrost melts. Methane comes out in big plumes, and that gets into the atmosphere, and as Stuart has shown, it has an impact which varies from 20 times as great as carbon dioxide to 90 times as great, depending on how you measure the timescale. So this is a very, very potent gas. It's already being released in increased quantities. We're seeing plumes of methane coming out of the Arctic seas during the summer. That's there increasing. And the fear is that the whole permafrost layer on the Arctic seabed will just melt away. And at that point, a massive release of methane will take place, which has been calculated that it could cause easily 0.6 of a degree of temperature-wise, more or less immediately, something I don't think the planet could easily stand. So these are reasons why we should be especially aware of sea ice and the need to bring it back. Even if we're not capable of warming, of cooling the climate effectively, we should pay special attention to bringing ice back. And there's a big problem and a challenge because we haven't got a good way of doing that. There's a way that has been proposed that they think will work to some extent. That's marine cloud brightening, where you release finely divided water particles, seawater particles, into the bases of the clouds, marine clouds, and that makes them brighter, and that makes the area locally cooler. So you can cool, according to our models anyway, you can produce local cooling that will allow sea ice to advance to some extent around the edges and bring some of it back. But that is not what you really want, which is to bring it back so it covers all the marginal seas of the Arctic in the summer. That's a much harder job. And personally, I don't know how we can do it. There's been some fanciful ideas advanced about pumping water over the ice, but I'm very dubious about their likelihood of success. So I think there's an open question for scientists still. Can we find a way to bring back Arctic sea ice, even in advance of finding a way to tackle global warming? Which the best way would probably be, or certainly would be, to remove carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. That would bring the climate under control. But we need urgently to actually cool part of the world, that's the part around the Arctic Ocean, so that we can bring back sea ice and not have it do all the damaging things which it's already started to do. So that's problem with Arctic ice and why the foundations who are trying to get something done are focusing on ice as a separate item from the rest. So
Peter, I have to ask you, I mean, you've been studying the Arctic sea ice from looking up above, from sonars on nuclear submarines, on many expeditions. You know, were you ever really concerned about your life on any of these expeditions? And, you know, what was it like? I assume it was very noisy in the submarine as it's crashing up through the ice, coming to the surface. Like, so what would be the first, most memorable experience you've had on one of these submarines? Or maybe you can't talk about it. It's classified.
No, I can. In fact, I think about it in my book. It's normally quiet and very comfortable. But it's first of all, it's very claustrophobic because nuclear submarines never come up to the surface. Old-fashioned diesel ones did, just charge batteries, but nuclear submarines like to hide under the ice, and that makes for claustrophobia if you're not a professional submariner. But one that I was on had a real emergency when there was an explosion on board, and two of the crew were killed, and the submarine nearly was lost. So that made you suddenly realise these are not safe vehicles for going around in the Arctic. I noticed, again, from Stuart Scott's talk, he had one of the frightening images that makes you afraid was Mike Pompeo making one of his idiot speeches. And he's most famous for an idiot speech he made to the Arctic Council early this year, in which he said that China was threatening the whole world by putting cargo on ships going through the Northern Sea Route, and that this threat had to be withstood by America by adding more to its nuclear strength in submarines and icebreakers and troops and everything in the Arctic. We have to defend ourselves against China, which is threatening us by sending cargo through the Northern Sea Route. And so that means there'll be more nuclear submarines in the Arctic, but patrolling around, accidentally hitting each other, or having accidents which can result in loss of life. So I'm not a fan anymore of submarines in the Arctic. There are better ways of doing it.
Right. Peter, do you want to make a few
comments?
I just want to reinforce that the reasons that Professor Lawrence just mentioned, that we have to do what we can, and we have to maintain the Arctic sea ice. We have to. Our very survival depends on that. And the reasons are that we have now entered another age, another terrible age, which is the age of Arctic multiple feedback, runaway global heating and climate change. This is what many of us have decades ago feared and believed would never be allowed to happen. So in the Arctic, we've got these enormous sources of feedback to global warming, which accelerate global warming. Permafrost is emitting, and NOAA has just acknowledged that we are now into a feedback situation. This is the first time that scientific organizations have acknowledged we are in a feedback situation. With the Arctic switching from a carbon source to a carbon sink to a carbon source, and emitting. The Arctic is emitting permafrost, and the subarctic wetlands, they're emitting more methane, far more carbon dioxide than anybody anticipated, and they're emitting nitrous oxide. So nothing could be worse. Nothing could be worse than the situation we're in with respect to the failure of policymakers and governments to realize that the Arctic has to be protected and the Arctic sea ice has to be maintained and conserved. Instead, these idiots, and we just saw an example of it in the last, from Stuart Scott, the last excellent presentation. These idiots are talking about benefits to the planet because the channel from Asia up to Europe and the United States will be opened up. What they're doing, and their policy and their aim is exactly the opposite to what we have been talking about for decades.
Right.
Has to happen. We have to keep that Arctic sea ice.
Yes. Thank you. And I just want to point, my last emphasis point is basically that, you know, everybody knows about climate adaptation, you know, that term, and right, same thing with climate mitigation. You know, in fact, the IPCC has volumes on each specific topic. We need to get climate restoration as being the third leg of the stool, if you like. We need whole chapters and whole, you know, we need people working on climate restoration. How do we restore a healthy climate? And I think, anyway, thank you for coming, and we'll just let Regina say a last few words to close out.
Sure, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Thank you for everyone for being here. It's occurred to me, as all of you on the panel are talking about climate disruption, we actually, I don't know if people on the feed who are watching this can hear the disruption that's happening down the hall, and that's with the youth of the world shouting to make their voices heard. And it's very impressive to me that they are quite voluble in this manner. And also, as you're talking about climate disruption, I'm talking or thinking in my head about climate distraction, which is that so many people are distracted. People are on their iPhones, people are on their computers, people are either on Facebook or they're taking photos and videos from Facebook. Virtual reality is about to end that up on a huge, much bigger level. And what I'm wondering is, you have so much information. How is it that we are going to attract their attention when people are able to live in a life when virtual reality is even more preferable than analog reality? So I think this is a very important issue. And yeah, thank you so much. I learned a lot from all of you. And my big wish is that all of the information here can somehow reach
Thank you.